I think I know how I want to answer it, but I just wanted to hear your thoughts. The question is, if somebody requests their house be prayed for or blessed because they suspect demonic activity, should a Christian do it, or is it unbiblical? And really, the reason I'm asking is because demon possession seems to only occur in people in the Bible and not in inanimate objects like a structure. Mm. So I'm just wondering if this would be like a misdirected prayer.
I understand. Yeah. Well, to say that something is unscriptural, that word can mean two different things. It could mean that it's against Scripture. In other words, the Bible forbids it. Or it could just mean it's extra-biblical, meaning that the Bible says nothing about it. You know, the Bible does not necessarily condemn it or recommend it. It's simply not in the Bible. The Bible does not talk, or at least not much, about geographical areas or houses or things like that being particularly possessed by demons. Now, Jesus did say when a demon goes out of a man, it wanders through waterless places seeking rest, and if it doesn't find any, it'll try to get back into the same guy that it came out of before. In the Old Testament, some of the prophets, like Isaiah, speak about deserts being a waste place and a habitation for demons. Actually, in this description of Babylon, mystery Babylon, the great in Revelation, it talks that it's become a habitation of demons. Now, that would suggest the possibility that demons are associated with places as well as persons. In fact, persons might simply be a kind of a place that they would be associated with when they possess people. And when they're not there, they're somewhere else. For example, they went into a herd of swine and possessed them. So my thought is that without having very much about it in the Bible, and certainly we don't have any biblical reference to praying over houses to get demons out of them and so forth, we could say it's extra biblical, meaning it's not found in the Bible, but it's not unbiblical in the sense of, you know, the Bible teaching against such things. Now, when you have the Bible really saying little or nothing about a subject, we have a couple of ways we can go. We can just say, well, if the Bible doesn't tell me what to do, I'm going to just not think anything about it. I'm not going to have an opinion, you know. On the other hand, there are times when Christian experience, especially widespread Christian experience, can inform us about the nature of things. After all, the Bible says very little at all about demons. It does have cases of demon possession mentioned, but there's not very much information about demons given. Yet there certainly must be truths about demons, which the Bible has not chosen to mention. And some of those truths, perhaps, could be learned by experience. And some people say, well, no, we just want to go by what the Bible says, not by experience. Experience is not reliable. Well, that's perhaps true. Experience is not as reliable as Scripture is. But then, for example, the Scripture mentions let's say epilepsy as a disease. It mentions it's some people that Jesus healed were epileptics. Now, it doesn't tell us very much about epilepsy, but science has discovered a great deal about epilepsy. So, in other words, we can know about certain things that the Bible mentions, but the Bible doesn't tell us much about them. We can learn things about them from experience and study in other areas. It's just that, of course, when we're talking about the unseen world, we don't have any source of information that's as reliable as the Bible. But that doesn't mean we don't have any source at all of information from experience. There are people who've had dealings with demons. For example, many Christians have never had the experience of even dealing with a demon-possessed person. But those who have learned things about dealing with demon-possessed people. You know, they've found out, you know, the things the demons might do or say. Because in the experience you do find things out that the Bible doesn't always expound upon. And therefore, I would say there are people who have had experiences that certainly give the impression that there are houses and places where demons have chosen to reside. It is possible that what we call haunted houses would fall into that category. But I've known more than one person, and myself included, who have been in houses that you know, it's subjective, of course, but have sensed or seen the presence of demons in those houses and where previous inhabitants also had seen them. So it would make a case, not a biblical case, but certainly not an anti-biblical case, that there could be houses that have become the haunt of demons. And I would suggest that praying over those houses or commanding demons to leave them would not be wrong. The Bible doesn't discuss that, but I would say this: there, in one case where I was in a house that had apparently been occupied by a Satanist, and there had been demons there, and I heard the demons every night. I commanded them to leave, and I never heard them again. You know, now that doesn't have quite the weight of Scripture, but it's it still is an experience, which I consider to be informative to me, and you know, there's certainly nothing in Scripture that would make that experience, you know, deceptive or wrong to believe. So, in terms of that, I would say that if someone says they believe there are demons in their house, or I don't know if there are or not in their house, but I don't see it as an impossibility, and I would tend to respond to a prayer request.
I'm just wondering how should I assess the sort of situation, because in the back of my mind, and just in some of the dialogue that I've had with this person, I don't know how much they understand about demons and the way they work biblically, at least. And so,
well, let's face it, there are superstitious people who think there's demons everywhere, that strange things happen, and they tend to over-diagnose demonic activity. But you might want to look into the case more. You might want to ask, okay, what exactly is going on that makes you think this is a case of demons? And there's all I can say. I mean, you wondered if it was like unbiblical. I'd say it's extra biblical. That is, it's something the Bible doesn't talk about. Whatever we know about it will come from somewhere else other than the Bible. But it's not anti-biblical.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we'll see what we can do about it then. Thank you.
Okay, Scott. I appreciate your call, brother. God bless. Okay, Jack from East Long Meadow in Massachusetts. Welcome to the Narrow Path, Jack.
Hey, Steve. My question is about Philippians 1:12-18. Just wonder if you could clarify that a little bit more for me, specifically where Paul is comparing and contrasting two different styles of preaching Christ, it seems.
Well, he says, let me read it. Paul says, "But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me," meaning his imprisonment, "have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evidence to the whole palace guard and to the rest that my chains are in Christ." So since Paul's become imprisoned among the palace, in the Roman palace, the guards have had a chance to know about his case and to hear the gospel from him. And he says, "And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident in my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear." So he's saying, because of my heroic endurance of persecution has encouraged other Christians to be heroic and to be bold in speaking the word without fear of imprisonment. Even though they may go to prison, they're not afraid of it, since they can see that I have gone, and it can be done. He says, "Some indeed preach Christ even from envy and strife, and some from goodwill." Now, it's not really clear what he means that some are preaching from envy and strife. He says more about those people in verse 16. He says, "The former preach Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains." Now, when he says they're supposing to add affliction to his chains, I don't know that he's saying that they deliberately want to add affliction to his chains, like they're trying to, you know, twist the knife in him. But it does seem to me be that the result of them doing so would tend to add, you know, more trials to his present trials. And now, who are these people? They are preaching Christ, he says, from selfish ambition, and they do it from envy and strife. Now, I don't know who it is they envy, but perhaps they envied Paul. Perhaps they are people who were in competition with Paul, which is perhaps what the word strife is suggesting, that they're competing with him, and they have selfish ambition. Perhaps, I think this probably means that there were people in the church in Rome or in Philippi he's in Rome, so I think he's talking about in his own town where he is, that were not fans of Paul, you know, and he was the big name preacher. He was the guy, you know, who everyone was talking about, all the Christians. He's the one who got all the converts. He's the one that, frankly, got all the attention in the church. And there were other preachers who apparently felt overshadowed or less recognized than Paul. And so now that Paul is cooling his heels in jail, these people have stepped forward to try to insert themselves into that place that Paul had filled in competition with him to make a name for themselves. It's selfish ambition that is motivating them. And he says others are preaching Christ, you know, for good enough motives, but some of them not. Some of them have always seen Paul as a competitor for the glory that they would like to have as, you know, successful preachers and heroes in the church. And now Paul's out of commission. So now they can step in and try to get that fame that they felt was preventing them from basking in. Now, he says of them, he says the latter, however, that is the other group, are doing it out of love, knowing that I'm appointed for the defense of the gospel. He says, what then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and in this I will rejoice, yes, and I will rejoice. I think what he's saying is that, yeah, I'm not all that happy about the way some of these people are motivated, but at least I can see a bright side. They are preaching Christ, and I'm glad to see Christ preached. You know, I could wish these people had a more spiritual motivation, and there are some who do. There are some who are doing it out of goodwill. He says there are some who are doing it out of love. There are some of them who respect Paul, and they know that he's set for the defense of the gospel, and they're supportive of him. But there are others who just want to step in and fill the void that Paul has left by being in prison, and they want to get some of the glory for themselves. Now, I think that he would say, you know, they'll have to answer to God for that. But, you know, as far as he's concerned, at least Christ is continuing to be preached, even though Paul's, as it were, out of commission in prison. So he can rejoice that the gospel's still going out. Now, as far as what that might apply to us today, we certainly have reason to believe that some people today would preach Christ for selfish reasons. There are some people who get fame out of being preachers. There are some who make a lot of money out of being preachers. And I don't say that those who are famous or who make a lot of money are necessarily doing it for those reasons. But since those things exist, the kind of people who would do it for those reasons almost certainly would be tempted to do it. And no doubt, there are some who do. Now, if these people are preaching the gospel well enough, then we can say, well, their motives, so, you know, God will have to judge that. We won't get involved in that. But at least Christ is being preached. The sad thing is that a lot of people who are preaching Christ for bad motives are also preaching a bad gospel. Of course, even people who preach for good motives sometimes preach a poor gospel, because there's a certain American brand of gospel preaching that is pretty standardized in the American churches, which leaves out a great deal of what Christ preached and what Paul preached. But anyway, if the true gospel is being preached, as apparently it was by some of these people who had not the most sterling motives for preaching it, Paul says, well, at least it's the gospel. At least it is being preached, and I'll rejoice in that.
Awesome. That clears it up, Steve. Thank you very much.
Okay, Jack. Thanks for your call. Linda from Akron, Ohio. Welcome to The Narrow Path. Thanks for calling.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a question. I have a question about Ecclesiastes 7:15-18. And should I just get to my question, or should I read that?
Either I'll read it or you might as well, since you've turned to it. I'm turning to it now.
Okay.
Go ahead.
All right.
Ahead.
I have it right here.
Okay.
Okay. In my vain life, I have seen everything. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man who prolongs his life in his evil doing. Be not overly righteous, and do not make yourself too wise. Why should you destroy yourself? be not overly wicked, neither be a fool. Why should you die before your time? It is good that you should take hold of this, and from that withhold not your hand, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. So I was just wondering, does that mean, like, don't try to be, like, perfectionistic or, like, just super good in order to affect the outcome of what happens in your life? Like, I know it doesn't, I know it can't mean to just be a little bit bad, but I mean...
Okay, don't be overly righteous, he says. What does that mean, don't be overly righteous? Why would you destroy yourself, he says. And don't be overly wise. Well, I don't think you can literally be overly righteous, overly wise. You either are righteous or you're not. You know, if you're not righteous, you're unrighteous. So obviously it's impossible literally to be overly righteous. And it's not possibly too wise. I mean, but you can be too wise in your own eyes and too righteous in your own eyes. You can be self-righteous, and you can be proud of your assumed wisdom, and so you could have too much. You could have too much, you know, self-righteousness and too much attitude of wisdom. But I'm not sure that's what he's referring to. He might be.
Well,
he might be talking that way, but he's certainly not saying. Yes.
No, I was just going to say, is that he's talking about how things are kind of, you know, upside down. Like sometimes somebody is righteous and they die early, and sometimes somebody's wicked and they live a long time. Would that be like him, his advice, like try get to, like, don't try to be, and it could be in your own eyes, I suppose, you know, but don't try to be so overly perfect or whatever, thinking that that's going to affect how the outcome of your life. But then on the other hand, here's the thing.
What he is saying is that he's seen people who were righteous who died anyway, and people who were unrighteous, and they seem to prolong their lives. So he's saying being righteous isn't going to necessarily guarantee, you know, the best outcome for you. And being unrighteous isn't necessarily going to guarantee a bad outcome for you. You might live long, unrighteous, or die young as a righteous person. Now, remember, Solomon is not here writing under inspiration. Solomon is giving his testimony about his past. This book is a testimony of Solomon talking about how he was away from God, and he was assessing things as one under the sun, meaning from an earthly vantage point. And so he's finding everything to be vanity. He said, I tried that. That was vanity. I checked into that. That was vanity too. Everything under the sun is vanity, except when he gets to the end of the book, he says, well, here the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. This is man's all, for he'll bring every thought into judgment. So he's written a book about his wandering from God, in which he talks about things he did and things he thought while he was away from God. For example, in chapter 9, he says, I thought...
Is this what he learned?
It's as if you were giving your testimony and you had been saved out of a Hindu background or a New Age background. And you were telling people, here's what I thought. You know, there's this karma thing, you know, and if you do a lot of good things, you'll have good karma. And then next time you come around in reincarnation, you'll be better off. And you start to describe the things that you believed before you were with the Lord. Now, this is part of your testimony. It's part of your past. You're explaining your thoughts at the time. But, of course, at the end, you say, but I have come to Christ, and I realize now that these things were false and that there's nothing but Christ and Scripture that I can trust anymore. Now, that's the kind of thing Solomon's doing in Ecclesiastes. You know, I was away from God. I was sensuous. I was rich. I indulged myself with every indulgence. I philosophized. I thought about things. I observed things. I thought this. I thought that. And one of the things he thought was that since he's seen some righteous people for whom it didn't go well, you know, they died young, and other people who were not so righteous and they did, you know, they got along just fine. So he says he decided, I think this is what he's saying. His advice at that time was, don't bother being too righteous. Don't bother being too wise. After all, it's not going to necessarily prolong your life. He's speaking as a worldly man. He's thinking of these things as a worldly man. You know, you don't want to be bad. You don't want to be evil. But don't knock yourself out. Don't be so hard on yourself that you have to, you know, just, you know, do everything right, because that's not going to make your life longer necessarily. I think that's a worldly way of thinking, and this is a place where he's sharing the worldly way of thinking that he had before he concluded, as he says at the end of the book, fear God and keep his commandments. So, in other words, this idea, don't be too wise, don't be too righteous. It's like in chapter 9, he says he had concluded that the dead don't know anything, that a person who dies is no different than a dog that dies. Well, that's not true. People and dogs are not the same in death. And so, I mean, the idea is he had a philosophy that it was kind of fluid. He was kind of searching for truth under the sun. And he's telling us in this book some of the conclusions he had reached tentatively. And I think, therefore, when he says, don't be overly wise, although I said it could be that he means don't be overly wise in your own eyes, which would be good advice, I think it's rather that he's talking about what his philosophy was when he wasn't really thinking right. You know, why be too righteous? You know, what good is it going to do you to be too righteous? You know, it's not going to hurt too bad to not be all that righteous. Lots of unrighteous people are, you know, live long and are wealthy and so forth. And this is a worldly way of thinking. I think he's describing a worldly way of thinking. And there's a lot of people who do think that way. You know, you don't want to be too bad, of course. You don't want to be criminal. You don't want to get God really upset with you. But, yeah, but don't knock yourself out trying to be, you know, perfect. But the Bible does say that we do forget the things that are behind and look toward the things that are before and press hard toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ to be perfect. It says in Hebrews chapter 6, let us go on to perfection. And so, you know, Solomon is expressing a view that isn't agreeable, really, with the New Testament teaching. But there's a lot of things in Ecclesiastes that aren't, because he's not affirming that this is true. He's affirming that this was his state of mind. This is what he thought when he was searching for meaning and seeking what is man's chief good under the sun. That is from a worldly point of view, not from God's point of view. Anyway, that's how I understand Ecclesiastes, and therefore, you can't just read Ecclesiastes to get doctrine, because it's not really a doctrinally reliable thing. It's sort of like reading Job, which a good portion of the book of Job is made up of the speeches made by Job's friends who were wrong. It says specifically in chapter 42 of Job that Job's friends did not speak rightly of God. Okay, but their speeches make up a dozen or more chapters in the book of Job. So you're going to read their speeches and realize what they are. They are the speeches of men who had certain opinions, but we're not told that they were inspired. We're not told that they were God's opinions. Likewise, Ecclesiastes is not necessarily expressing God's opinions, but Solomon's saying, I thought this. I reasoned this way. This is what I concluded. But he's not saying he was right. Anyway, that's how I would take that kind of a passage. Listen, we need to take a break, but we're not done. There's another half hour of broadcasting still to come. At this point, we simply like to let our listeners know what some perhaps do not know, and that is that we are listener-supported. From time to time, people indicate that they think that we are paid by the radio stations to be on. The opposite is true. We pay the radio stations. Almost all of the radio programs you listen to pay the radio stations for the time, and we do too. If you like, we don't have any advertisers, we don't have any sponsors, and we don't sell anything, so we depend on listeners. If you'd like to help us stay on the air, you can write to The Narrow Path, P.O. Box 1730, Temecula, California, 92593. You can also donate at thenarrowpath.com, where everything is free at thenarrowpath.com. I'll be back in 30 seconds, so don't go away.
The book of Hebrews tells us, do not forget to do good and to share with others. So let's all do good and share the narrow path with Steve Gregg with family and friends. When the show is over today, tell one and all to go to thenarrowpath.com where they can study, learn, and enjoy with free topical audio teachings, blog articles, verse-by-verse teachings, and archives of all the Narrow Path radio shows. And be sure to tell them to tune into the show right here on the radio. Share listener-supported The Narrow Path with Steve Gregg. Share and do good.
Welcome back to the Narrow Path radio broadcast. My name is Steve Gregg, and we're live for another half hour taking your calls. Our lines are full once again, but they do open up in the course of the half hour. Of course, when we talk to somebody and they move along, their line is open. And if you want to try to get into one of those lines in the next half hour, you can call this number, 844-484-5737. And just so we might take as many callers as possible, let's get right to it and talk to John from Jackson, Wyoming. John, welcome to the Narrow Path. Thanks for calling.
Hey, Steve. One of the things I'm going to be thankful for is that I found your program a little over a year ago.
Well, but, I'm thankful that you did, too. I'm glad you like it. Thank you.
Last week, you were talking with a gal at the end of the program and talking about reprobate minds. Mm-hmm. And to tell you the truth, I almost fell out of my chair when you said that you believe most politicians had a reprobate mind. So I don't know that if you meant it tongue in cheek, and I would tend to agree with you, but I about fell out of my chair laughing.
Well, when I said most, of course, I don't know the statistics. It may be that most of them do not. It may be that there's more who do not have a reprobate mind than those who do, but it seems like the ones who are making most of the decisions apparently have no conscience. I mean, having a reprobate mind, I think, is comparable to being a sociopath, and that is that all you care about is yourself. You don't care about what happens to anybody else. You have no conscience. And certainly those who are making policies for us, the majority of the voting legislators, and, of course, it would seem to me a lot of those on the courts and in the White House definitely do not care what happens to people. They only care about their own power.
I certainly agree. And a couple of weeks ago, you were talking with a person about church history, and you were recommending several books. And I got one of those books by a man named Gonzalez, The Story of Christianity.
Yeah.
And I'm only a couple chapters into it, but I feel like he's probably a liberal in his theology just because he mentioned that John, that wrote the gospel, did not write Revelation.
Well, that's not a liberal view.
I had not heard that.
Yeah, that's not a liberal view. I disagree with him on that. But there are many conservatives who have held that view. In fact, that's one of the reasons why Revelation was withheld from the canon of the New Testament until about 397 AD, because some Christians in the first three centuries thought that Revelation was written by the Apostle John, and other Christians, other churches, believed that it was written by some other John. Some of them thought it was written by a presbyter in Ephesus named John, who was not the apostle. Now, the problem is Revelation, you know, the author of Revelation simply calls himself John. He doesn't say which John he is, but I think the evidence is very strong that it's the Apostle John. It is also the view of most of the church fathers that say anything about it. They seem to believe that that was the Apostle John. But there were churches throughout the world who, when they read Revelation, they thought, well, this can't be written by the same John. And they, and since the writer of Revelation didn't call himself the Apostle John, but just John, there's always been room for people to have a different opinion. I don't think the other opinion is correct. I think the evidence is very good that it's the Apostle John. But a person who would say they don't think that was the same author would not be a liberal per se. They'd be taking one of the alternative viewpoints that's been around since Revelation was written, pretty much.
Well, I think his evidence was the style of writing. He said the style of writing for the gospel and the style of writing for Revelation was just so different that it could not be made by the same person.
Well, that is the complaint. The Gospel of John and the Epistles of John are written in a particular style of Greek, a very literate style of Greek, whereas Revelation is written in very choppy, illiterate kind of Greek. In fact, many scholars, including very conservative scholars, have said Revelation, the Greek in Revelation, is almost like somebody who's writing a language that's for him as a second language, and he doesn't really know how to write the Greek very well. That is something that all Revelation scholars agree about, whether they believe John the Apostle wrote it or not. It's not like a disputed thing. The writing of Revelation is in very, very poor Greek, and that's not true of the other letters of John. However, that doesn't mean the same writer didn't write them. After all, in the book of Acts, it says that John and Peter were essentially illiterate or untrained, uneducated men. And that being so, it's very possible that John didn't write very good Greek. But he wrote the gospel and the epistles, no doubt, from Ephesus, where in the church there would be what he'd have access to what they call an amanuensis. Most of the letters in the New Testament were written with the help of an amanuensis, which means somebody to whom the writer dictated. And the amanuensis was like a scribe taking down what they wrote, but not just always verbatim. They were taking those thoughts and putting them down in a literary form. And therefore, as John would, for example, dictate the stories of the life of Jesus that we find in the Gospel of John, in all likelihood, someone, an amanuensis in Ephesus, where he was, would be able to tell those stories in smooth and literate Greek, even if John didn't speak it that well. Now, Revelation may have been written from notes that he took while he was on the island of Patmos, which didn't allow him to use an amanuensis, which would allow, of course, for the Greek to be much inferior to the Greek of the other writings. And many conservative people, myself included, feel that that is the case, that John did not use an amanuensis for Revelation, which then reflects his own poor usage of Greek. But he did have an amanuensis which gave a more literary cast to his other writings, the Gospel and the Epistles. But not everyone agrees with that. Some people just say, you can't be the same author. But there's so many things in Revelation, phrases, special words, special concepts, that are not found anywhere else in the Bible except in John's other writings. For example, when Jesus is called the Lamb in Revelation. Well, the only other place in the Bible that refers to Jesus as the Lamb is John, chapter 1. There's that Jesus is called the Word in Revelation 19. No other writings in the Bible call Jesus the Word except John 1 and 1 John 1. In other words, referring to Jesus as the Lamb or referring to Jesus as the Word, these are uniquely Johannine expressions for Jesus, and they are found in Revelation and in John's other writings, but not anywhere else in the whole Bible. And actually, there's a long list of those kinds of things. There's so much in common that Revelation has with the Gospel and the Epistles of John that it'd be very strange for some other author to write Revelation and have so many of John's own unique phrases and things in it. So I personally, I explore this in my book, Revelation 4 Views. I actually explore the authorship question, and I have a long list there of the kinds of phrases that are found in Revelation and only in John's other writings, which are, inclined me to think that it's the same John. Anyway, the author of the book on church history, I don't know that he's a liberal. He might even be a Roman Catholic, I'm not sure. But generally speaking, the theological leanings of a historian don't have to compromise the value of his historical narrative. But he is giving an interpretation there. If he says, well, John the Apostle didn't write the book of Revelation, he is stating something that many Christians in the early church would have agreed with him on, and some do today, many do today, but I don't. It's just, it's not as if he's a liberal. He's just got a different opinion on a controversial point.
Well, I have one other comment if you have time.
All right, quickly.
I finished your book on the three views of hell not too long ago.
Uh-huh.
And I've heard you speak several times on the radio program. But I think it's time to come out of the closet and go ahead and declare yourself a restorationist.
Think so? Well, I'm not sure that I would be a restorationist, but I'm definitely sympathetic toward it. I mean, that's obvious. But I'm also sympathetic toward annihilation. So, I mean, that's the problem. I don't know which view I hold. I didn't know when I wrote the book, and I don't know now. I haven't made up my mind. But I'm not ashamed to say that I could be a restorationist or I could be a conditionalist. Those are two different views, and I think both of them have a very good chance of being correct biblically. As far as the traditional view, obviously, you can tell, even read my book and from what I say, that I think the traditional view has much less merit scripturally and in terms of what the Bible teaches about the character of God. But you know, having said that, I still have not landed on one or the other. But, yeah, I am very sympathetic toward the restoration view, very much. And but I'm not, I can't declare myself a restorationist because there's a possibility in my mind that annihilation may be correct.
Well, thanks a lot, Steve.
All right. I appreciate your call. God bless you. Bye now. Okay, let's talk to Miguel from Stockton, California. Miguel, welcome to The Narrow Path. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Greg.
Hello. It's Steve, actually. Go ahead. There's a lot of noise in your background.
Yeah, 22, Deuteronomy 22:9. Uh-huh. I had trouble with the last word when I looked it up. It's in the Strong's Concordance and in both Bibles that I have. It says defiled.
Yeah? Yes?
Yes, and in the transliteration, just about every other definition, the majority defines it as the opposite of defiled.
What do you mean the opposite? What would the opposite be?
I'm at work, so I don't have the concordance with me.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the alternative is, but yeah, I'm not looking at the Hebrew, but I don't have a problem with the word defiled there, and it seems like it would work in the sentence. It says, you shall not sow your vineyard with different kinds of seed, lest the yield of your seed which you have sown and the fruit of your vineyard be defiled. Defiled means ritually corrupted. It doesn't mean that it's got a physical problem. It means that it's ritually corrupted. And sort of like, you know, if you touch a dead body, you're defiled, you're unclean. So it's not really saying that your crops will be bad. It just means they'll be unclean and not acceptable.
Yeah, and I agree. It works great in the reading, but it's just when I looked up the word defiled to see what other definitions could be used. I think it was out of maybe 9 or 10 different definitions, only defiled was one. The only one that was negative. Everything else was a positive.
Oh, okay. Well, I have to say, I don't know what the Hebrew... I don't know what the Hebrew word is, but I can look it up after the program, and if I learn anything valuable, I could bring it up on a later show.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, because I don't know what the word is in the Hebrew, but I'll check on that. You got me curious now. Thank you. Okay, Leroy from Covina, California, where I grew up. Hi, Leroy.
Hi, Steve. Like John, a couple of callers before, I am very thankful for having found you probably about 3 months ago as I was driving. And I was enamored by questions that you, the answer that you gave to a question. And so I've been listening ever since.
Well, great. I'm glad to have you join us.
Yeah. So my question to you today, two short ones, concerning the word character, which, you know, the Bible, the dictionary defines as the mental and moral qualities distinctive to an individual.
Uh-huh.
Right? So I've recently been in a debate with a close friend of mine. He lives in the UK, and he's kind of like the doubting Thomas. He's always been on the fence, and it seems to me he's very close to coming to faith, but, I mean, he's the kind of one that if he does, it's not without being, you know, without a lot of questions and kicking against the goads.
Sure. Okay, yeah, so you're saying that he may be coming toward faith, but he has a lot of questions unanswered, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes, yeah. And so the recent debate that we've been having, you know, he said that a pastor told him that God doesn't change your character, you know, and I'm that just didn't sit right with me, you know.
Right.
So what would you say about that?
I would disagree. I'm not sure why a pastor would say that God doesn't change your character. I think that's exactly what God intends to change. As you say,
exactly.
it's your qualities, your personal qualities. Now, the pastor might have meant something else. It, you know, not everyone talks very clearly about character. Some people have different ideas. Maybe the pastor thought personality. Maybe he said, well, your personality will be the same even after you're a Christian, or your personhood or something. But no, character is definitely your integrity, your values, you know, your habits, and, you know, what you are internally by nature. I mean, clearly there are actions. There are actions that would go against your character, and which perhaps a different person, a different character, those actions would not. And when we talk about the character of God, you know, that's very important, because some doctrines seem to compromise God's character. You know, what are his values? What is he really like? Now, to say that God doesn't change your character is simply not what the Bible teaches. The Bible indicates that we're to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, and that we're to be changed from glory to glory into the image of Christ. Certainly that's not our visual look. It's our character that's being changed. We become more loving. The fruit of the Spirit makes us more loving, more gentle, more faithful, more good, more self-controlled. I mean, these are the fruits of the Spirit, and they certainly have to do with your character. So I think the pastor's either just wrong, or else he's thinking of something different in terms of what he's calling character. And I'm not sure what that would be.
Yeah, well, my answer to my friend, having told me that's what he heard from that pastor, was that pastor is in the category of a false teacher, you know. Mm. And that my friend seemed to agree with this pastor, because he had his own explanation as to how, I think he just as in the fact that we know that different characters have penned the Bible, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think maybe some pastors with whom I would not agree, they may see the work of God as not changing you at all, but just forgiving you. You know, there used to be a bunch of popular bumper stickers, Christian bumper stickers that said, Christians are not perfect, just forgiven. Well, that's not true.
Yeah.
It is true Christians are not perfect, but it's not true that they're just forgiven. We are forgiven, but that's not all. Being a Christian doesn't mean I get, you know, I live like a prodigal, never come home to be obedient to my father, but I'm just forgiven while I'm living in the far city with the prostitutes and eating swill with the swine. No, we change. We come back to our father. We come back into a life of obedience. We renounce our sinful past and live differently. So, but some people don't know that. Some people preach a kind of a twisted kind of a gospel that makes, you know, what Jesus accomplished is just to change God's attitude toward us, but not change us. So we don't have to stop sinning. We don't have to become any better. We just have to believe, and then God looks at us as if we were better, but he doesn't change anything. And that's a very, what we call a hyper-grace view, which is not at all what the Bible teaches.
Hyper-grace, you call it?
Well, if that's what that pastor believes, yeah, there's a teaching called hyper-grace, which is the idea that, you know, you don't have to do anything except believe, and you don't have to change anything. God just gives you grace and, you know, kind of treats you differently, even though you're not treating him any differently. But, that's a false doctrine that's out there. And I don't know if in the UK if that's a popular doctrine out there or not. But the pastor might mean that, or he might simply mean something different by the word a character.
Well, you know, I told him that my friend, that is, that it didn't seem like what he was espousing agreed with, was in agreement with Scripture. So I gave him Romans 12:2.
Right.
I gave him 2 Corinthians 5:17, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I also gave him Romans 3:10, you know, there is no one righteous, no, not one. So therefore, God needs to change you know.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're going to run out of time here pretty quick. Did you have a second question?
Yes. The second question is, why is it that we have to pray for the peace of Israel, physical Israel?
Well, we don't. That's in the Psalms. In the Psalms, it says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. A great peace have they that love her. That's back when Jerusalem was the capital of God's people. God's people were the nation of Israel back then under the old covenant. And, you know, God's people don't have a capital city anymore. Because God's people are those who are in Christ. Jews and Gentiles who are in Christ are God's people. And we don't have a geographical location. But back when David wrote, frankly, Jerusalem was his capital city, and he was the ruler over God's people, Israel. And therefore, to pray for its security and for its peace and so forth, we're to basically pray that God's kingdom, Israel, at the time, would, you know, that it go well for them. And so there are people who still quote that as if we're supposed to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, the city in the Middle East today, but it's no longer the capital of God's people. Israel is, the nation of Israel is not a godly country. They don't love God. They're not even observant. There's observant Jews there, and there's even Christian Jews there, but the church, the country itself is secular and dualistic, and frankly, they have every kind of belief system there, and they're not officially a God-oriented country, and therefore they're not like the country of Israel. They're not like the country of Israel in the Old Testament. In the Bible, the nation of Israel was founded on a covenant that God made with them at Mount Sinai. The nation of Israel today has no reference to that covenant. They don't have any reference to the covenant, and they are not a religious nation. They're just a secular democracy like us.
Well, unfortunately, and it's always bothered me, my pastor always closes a prayer, like we have a prayer meeting every Tuesday morning. Mm-hmm. He always says to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And well, I do happen to know that he's a dispensationalist, which I'm not.
Yeah.
So I think it's something that dispensationalists seem to be
Let me suggest something to you. Yeah, so we can maybe get to another caller before we're out of time here. But let me just suggest you go to my website, thenarrowpath.com. And go look at the topical lectures series and find the series called What Are We to Make of Israel? It's a series that I think covers a lot of these things, and it interacts with the dispensationalists, but it disagrees with them. It's called What Are We to Make of Israel? And it can be, everything's free at our website. So you just go there, you can listen to those lectures there. And I think you'll find it probably agreeable with what you believe. And probably helpful in answering some questions those people have. I appreciate your call. I want to try to get one more call in if I can. Nathan from San Diego, California. Welcome to The Narrow Path. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Steve. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
I have two questions. My first question, kind of go together, is in the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve, after God had created everything and it was good, it seems like it's just the next sentence that the fall of man is, you know, literally like a week away, or, you know, from my mind, I would read it that way. But is it possible that it was, you know, 50 years or a longer time frame than that?
Well, it could have been more than a day or a week, but probably was not very long, because Adam and Eve, as soon as they were created, were set about the task of procreating. God commanded them to be fruitful and to multiply and to fill the earth, and I'm sure they got right to it. Now, we find that the first child born to them was Cain, and that was after the fall. So, in fact, it would appear that Cain was conceived after the fall. That's the impression we get, which means that they fell before even their first child was conceived. Now, you know, I don't know how long into the month it would have been till Eve was, you know, able to conceive after she was created, but it seems to me that it would not be possible for the fall to be more than a couple of weeks after they were created, since they fell before she conceived the first child.
I see. And then kind of my second question was, after the fall, God explained that she would have like labor pains.
Mm-hmm. Increased pain in childbirth, sorrow. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So my question was, before the fall, is it possible that she conceived a child before then?
No. I mean, we read of the first child that she conceived in chapter 4, which is after the fall.
Huh. Because I'm just assuming, how would she know if God's explaining that she would have pains, labor pains, like how?
Well, I mean, God could explain that to her whether she'd experience it or not. For example, when God said, the day you eat it, you'll die. Well, they had never died. They didn't know what dying was, but he still told them they would die. When he told her she'd have labor pains, she had never had them, but she now knows that she's going to have them. I mean, God's telling them, but that doesn't mean she's had that experience previously. You've been listening to The Narrow Path radio broadcast. We are listener supported. Our website is thenarrowpath.com. Have a good Thanksgiving, and let's talk again Monday. God bless you.